Somebody shake me, I'm dreaming. A private owned company wants to take me and talk it sound, you see. 24 square miles of towers, spinning profits for the corporate powers. Save our sound, save our sound, Nantucket Sound. Silent new screen, save our sound, save our sound, Nantucket Sound. Don't let them get their way. Each tower tears up your shoe show. 16 feet wide and 80 deep, as our record system rolls. This power isn't cheap.
Hi, thanks for joining us. My name is Kate Dineen, and I'm the Communications Manager at the Alliance to Protect Nantucket Sound. The Alliance is a nonprofit environmental organization dedicated to the long-term preservation of Nantucket Sound. We're undoubtedly best known for our vocal opposition to the Cape Wind Project proposed for Horseshoe Shoal in Nantucket Sound, which we view as the greatest and most immediate threat to the sound. The woman to my left is Audra Parker. She is the Director of Strategic Planning at the Alliance. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Hi, Katie.
So while we have Audra and her expertise here today, we're just going to discuss a little bit about the federal review of the Cape Wind Project, which has been underway since the winter, and there have been some exciting new developments. So what's going on with the federal review right now?
Well, the first thing I want to say, Katie, is that Cape Wind is not a done deal by any means, and it's being reviewed not just at the federal level, but also at state and local levels.
Okay.
So there's a great number of permits Cape Wind would still need to receive to go forward. At the federal level, they came out with what's called a DEIS, or Draft Environmental Impact Statement, and that's basically a comprehensive document that's supposed to analyze all the different impacts this project would pose to birds, to fisheries, to the local tribes, to just a whole host of impact areas. And the DIS basically concluded that this large 130 turbine project covering 25 square miles of Nantucket Sound would have fairly minimal impacts.
Wow.
However, since then, there's been a public comment period, and a lot of the key agencies, peer agencies like the Bureau of Indian Affairs, mm-hmm. which is basically peer to Mineral Management Service, which is running the DIS, and groups like U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service have been very critical of the comments in the DIS and some of the conclusions that have been reached. So we'll talk a little bit about that later, but the point is that the DIS is just a draft document, mm-hmm. and there's been a lot of criticism to the conclusions and the methodology that was used in that document.
So criticism not just by individuals or even organizations, but by actual federal agencies?
Exactly. There are a great number of comments, both from individuals mm-hmm. as well as from agencies, but some of the key agencies, like the government ones we're talking about, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Bureau of Indian Affairs, mm-hmm. National Fisheries, Marine Services, a lot of those had very harsh criticisms of the way the process was conducted, the methodologies used, and ultimately the conclusions of low impact. So Mineral Management Service needs now to address those comments before they can come out with a final. And what we're hearing is they're shooting for a final by the end of the year.
Mm-hmm.
So they basically take all the comments that they've received, they have to address them all before they issue a final, and then the final would be followed by what's called a record of decision, which is ultimately, you know, a denial or a permitting of the project.
And worst case scenario, even with all this criticism, if MMS gives Cape Wind a thumbs up, does that mean that the project will still move forward?
Well, that's a good question. That's what I was saying. There's been a lot of local and state interaction as well. I think there's probably about 20-odd permits that they need to get. We've already seen a denial on mm-hmm. what's called a procedural basis from the Cape Cod Commission that Cape Wind is now trying to appeal. But they would have to not just jump through the MMS permit hoop,
right.
but there's a whole host of other permits that they would have to get. And basically what we've been seeing, this project has been going on for 7 years.
Yeah.
There's a lot of controversy. There's a lot of conflict. We're seeing promising alternatives in deep water, like mm-hmm. this Blue H floating turbine. With just all the criticism, all the mounting evidence, the high cost that we're seeing mm-hmm. that MMS itself reported, I mean, it's time to deny this project and move on to something that we can all embrace.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so just back to the federal process for a minute. Mm-hmm. In addition to these written comments that people submitted, back in March there were a series of public hearings. Right. Can you talk a little bit about what happened there?
Yeah, the public hearings were really encouraging. We went through a similar thing 3 years ago when, mm-hmm. or 4 years ago at this point, when the Army Corps was the lead federal agency. And we had public hearings then in Yarmouth, mm-hmm. on Nantucket, in Martha's Vineyard, and in Boston. And while there was a great deal of opposition then, the round of hearings we just went through in, I think, the March timeframe, mm-hmm. the opposition was really overwhelming, and it was all walks of life. It wasn't a NIMBY phenomenon, as right. Cape Wind likes to describe, but there were people that, you know, fishermen that are earning their livelihoods in Nantucket Sound came out in, you know, large numbers, particularly in Martha's Vineyard. Even in Boston, where the core of support is greater because it's further away from right. sort of further away from ground zero.
The farther away you get, the better
right.
it looks.
Right, exactly. The opposition was really overwhelming, and people spoke to fisheries issues, they spoke to public safety impacts, people from the airports were concerned, people from the local ferry lines, you know, boaters, fishermen, and the tribes came out too in very, very vocally in opposing this project because of the impact it would have to them both culturally and religiously. So we really saw a great deal of opposition, and I think the numbers bear it out. It was probably, you know, 70% against, with everyday citizens, with groups, and with a lot of the local elected officials. So it was very encouraging.
So these were substantive comments pointing to the deficiencies of the document, not just I'm against Cape Wind. So that should have
right.
a lot of weight.
That's right. I mean, I think it was both. People were expressing their opposition to Cape Wind, mm-hmm. but they were addressing, as they were supposed to, that DIS or that draft statement, and talking about some of the issues and some of the problems that they saw in that. And while they were basically saying that, you know, these impacts are not minimal. For example, in the DIS, they said that the impact to aviation would be, I forget if it was negligible or minor, but mm-hmm. pretty insignificant. At the same time, the FAA has changed their determination from one of no hazard to one of presumed hazard, which means they, who have the expertise, are going to continue to study some of the concerns around radar interference mm-hmm. and some of the concerns, particularly around VFR operations, visual flight rule operations, before they ultimately say whether it's a hazard or not. But we've got MMS at the same time saying, no, it's negligible, and the FAA hasn't even come out with anything. Wow. So that's just one, you know, glaring mm-hmm. red flag in the DIS, which, you know, leads us to believe, as well as a lot of other groups, to believe that it was just critically flawed, and we can't base any kind of permit decision on this document.
So before we launch into some clips from the Yarmouth hearing, are there any other updates that we should know about right now?
No, I think just the fact that people should understand that on a federal level, mm-hmm. this was just a draft document. It was in a way premature because the other thing that Mineral Management Service has to do at the same time as they're permitting Cape Wind or going through the permit process, they're supposed to be establishing regulations for overall how do you permit any kind of renewable energy project on the Outer Continental Shelf. Mm-hmm. Because Cape Wind came in before there was any process in place.
Right.
That's why we saw the movement from the Army Corps of Engineers mm-hmm. to MMS, but we're basically saying this is premature. How can you permit a single project in the absence of this regulations, or why would you even do that? Mm-hmm. So we're seeing that, you know, that needs to happen. Those regulations need to be put in place, and that should be happening shortly.
Okay.
The FAA should be going through their studies. The Coast Guard still is to complete final terms and conditions, which was congressionally mandated to ensure safe navigation on Nantucket Sound. So all those things should come into place before any kind of final environmental impact statement okay. is issued. And the other thing that we've been talking about, as well as some of the local elected officials, is there's something called a consensus management process. And that's really saying, fine, we all understand we need renewable energy, but this project is so conflicted, mm-hmm. has so many downsides to it, is so expensive. Why doesn't the community and the affected stakeholders get involved in this process and find a solution that we can embrace? So we're hoping that that's an alternative so that we can finally, you know, deny Cape Wind, get that off the table, and find something that we really can embrace.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of people wonder, you know, why don't the affected communities, the citizens of the Cape and Islands, ever get an opportunity to vote on this project? You know, there have been several non-binding referendums, but nothing tangible. So this would be a way to gather feedback from the
right.
community to come towards some sort
right.
of solution.
Exactly. And you raise a good point. I mean, I think it's worth noting that in the two towns, which were Nantucket and Mashpee, mm-hmm. where they did have town votes, the vote in opposition was something like 2-1. So again, we're seeing overwhelming opposition to this project. I know Cape Wind likes to quote these surveys that have had very, very small sample sizes of Cape and Island residents. And if you just look at the results of the hearings, you talk to people on the streets, you see what happened in these non-binding town votes that you brought up, it's overwhelming. The opposition to this project has and remains strong, widespread, deep, and overwhelming.
And on that note, now we'll give you some clips from the Yarmouth hearing, which occurred on March 10th at Mattakese Middle School. And right now, this is some testimony you'll see, just some excerpts of some very powerful comments made by public officials. So this is just a snapshot of the hearing. But this hearing in particular was, you know, a display, as you'll see in the beginning. It was just very energized. You'll see a lot of Save Our Sound stickers, you know, vocal opposition, but there were some really substantive comments that you'll see in the forthcoming clips. But after that, I hope you'll stay with us because we'll be discussing some of the key comments a bit more from federal agencies and organizations and some next steps that we all can take this summer to ensure that Cape Wind is in fact denied. Thanks.
And I really appreciate you letting me come here without any regulations whatsoever. Arrgh, it's a fighting thing to find a treasure like this down here. No regulations! What a great idea!
And there's no for sale!
What do you mean not it's not for sale? I'd be more than happy to take it. I'll take it. It's not for sale. I'm not going to be buying it. I'm going to be taking it is what I'm going to be doing.
Fundamental flaw in the whole situation as we see it go forward. Over the last 7 years, my constituents have been arguing over this issue. The proponents have been saying we need to do this to save the planet. The critics have been saying if we do this, we're going to destroy our community. And in the end, there's been a lot of acrimony and a lot of division. You can hear a lot of that here tonight. And I think much of that could have been avoided and should have been avoided. The federal government had done what it should have done, which is to develop a federal ocean management that sets up a comprehensive planning process and requires the private interests to conform to a public agenda. Thank you very much.
As a Coast Guard licensed boat captain, I agree with the High Line and Steamship Authority when they say the wind towers will present a navigational hazard. I believe the Coast Guard terms and conditions for safe navigation should be in place and a part of the DEIS report. I do not understand how we can allow the risk of a 40,000-gallon oil storage platform to be built a few miles off one of the most pristine beaches in the world. In this regard, I concur with the town of Barnstable's position of the potential environmental damage of an oil spill in Nantucket Sound.
I, like everyone else who lives on Cape Cod, has friends from all over the United States, and occasionally, one of them who has never seen an ocean will come to Barnstable, and the first thing they want to do is bring themselves and their children down to look at the ocean. And anyone who would suggest that looking out at these things isn't a befouling of that coastline doesn't have the same sense of aesthetics that I do.
I will tell you that there's no doubt in the minds of many fishermen who I talk to, and I'm a commercial fisherman myself, I live in Chatham, no doubt that this project will have a negative impact on their livelihood. And there's no doubt in the colony from the Chamber of Commerce here tonight, no doubt in their minds that this project will also have a negative impact on the economic viability of the Cape.
Taking away the horseshoe would be a vital resource that we depend on as a tourism-based community to fund our summers, to make us a viable community for our summer homes, which are the south side of our town. Basically takes up 51% of our tax base. So when you start to affect that, that is going to affect our whole community. The other reason that I'm up here tonight is I'm representing the Mattaquamong Tribe. I am the Tribal Historic Preservation Officer of the tribe, and I'm also the Assistant Environmental Administrator. the tribe Mashpee Wampanoag. Wampanoag means people of the first light. Historical, cultural, religious values that we place on the Sound are immense. Celestial ceremonies are held, the blocking of those views of that sunrise would be an issue to the tribe.
We are going to ask environmental questions that concern eelgrass, concern velocity zones where hurricanes are going to come in, concern where the transition faults where cables are going to be joined from land cables to sea cables, and they're going into hurricane velocity zones. They're all the devils in the details. These questions have not been answered. The environmental issues have not been addressed accurately and appropriately. We do not have even one iota of information on the impact of the cable, and that doesn't even address the wind towers. I'm talking about just specifically the cable.
It is only through a windfall and tax credits that this project is economically feasible. If, in fact, our tax dollars, the citizens' tax dollars, are going to subsidize this project, then it needs to be in the best place for its citizens, not for its developer or corporate sponsors.
Yarmouth, Barnstable, and Mashpee are really the abutters of the project, as well as the islands. We are, and I think Mashpee, and we discussed this, Chuck and I discussed this quite a bit, we would be the first responders to any disaster that would happen out here. And yet nobody has involved us in any of the processes, state, federal, or anything in discussions on how this would all be handled. We haven't got the equipment, we haven't got the training, and we haven't got the money to buy the equipment and to train our people for the types of disasters that could happen if these things were built.
There may be appropriate places where turbines could be sited without negatively impacting our historic landscape. This is historic landscape. Our tourism, which is our lifeblood. Navigation channels, both the air and the sea. Migrating mammals and fish. These places need to be carefully identified, limited, and zoned with the full cooperation and consideration of local government and of the resident and stakeholders.
But in this case, you have public property that you're about to hand over to a private corporation without the public having said. You have a federal election coming up in November. You folks are from the federal government. Maybe you should bring this back to the voters of Cape Cod. We have one county here, Barnstable County, which is also known as the Cape Cod Regional Government. Let's have the voice of the people heard, because I'm confident the people will make the right decision. They won't just give away public property for nothing. Subsidies. In order for this project to take place, we all know subsidies are part of the equation. So you're going to give our money to a corporate billionaire, on top of the public property you're going to give it. So now, it's a necessity. That electricity that we're ultimately going to pay for, nobody has made it clear as to what it is actually going to cost when this project is created.
Now, when I asked for a financial plan, when I suggested that hasn't existed, hasn't been given to us, what we're told, and if I'm wrong, please let us know, that the cost is going to be double or triple the current cost of electricity. Is it? I hear someone say wrong. Well, if it is, present that to us. And that is with state, federal subsidies and tax incentives. We need to know what the cost is. We need to see what the financial plan is. Barnstable, I will tell you, has nationally recognized financial planners and budget directors. We can look at the numbers and see if they make sense and work. We're willing to work with anybody to make this work. This project here doesn't work.
But in addressing the economics on page 17 of Appendix F, when you're discussing the various sites that were considered, your report clearly states that none of the sites appear to be profitable at today's electric prices. Now here on Cape Cod, we have some of the highest utility rates in the country. Your report indicates that ISO New England charges $59 per kilowatt hour, and the projected wholesale cost that Cape Wind would be selling their electricity at is 122 megawatt hours. Now, that's more than 100% increase for where it is right now. Last time I checked, we were hovering about $106 per barrel of oil. And at the prices that we're at today, based on the release of your document on January 11, 2008, it's not a viable product.
We think it's clear that the draft report ignored the concerns of pilots, airline operators, airport managers of the three major airports around the Sound, that the Cape Wind turbines may create a very potential hazard to flights between the Cape and the islands. There's approximately 400,000 flights, 160,000 roughly IFR, 240,000 roughly VFR, that's instrument flight. Both commercial and non-commercial over the Sound, and that's yearly. Part of our job as commissioners, operators, whatever, at the airports to ensure the safety of all who fly to and from our airports. The well-being of air crews and passengers may well be compromised by these 130 towering turbines, blades 44 stories high. Why would anybody want to put an obstruction like that and create a risk that doesn't now exist?
Hi, thanks for staying with us. Now, as you saw in those public hearing clips from the March 10th public hearing in Yarmouth, several individuals addressed the cost of the Cape Wind project. Audra, can you tell us a little bit about what exactly that means and specifically what that might mean for ratepayers?
Yeah, we've basically been saying all along that offshore wind, particularly offshore in an offshore environment, mm-hmm. is expensive, and we've seen a huge increase in cost since Cape Wind was first proposed. When they were first proposing their project back in 01 or 02, they were talking about a $750 million project. And now it's, well north of $1 billion. We don't know what the exact number is, but it's probably, $1.5 billion, maybe even more. So we've seen huge increases in steel prices. We've mm-hmm. seen a shortage of manufacturing capacity. So the prices of this, or the capital investment, has gone up hugely. And while a lot of people believe that this is inexpensive because wind is free, mm-hmm. What we're seeing is that capital cost of harnessing and capturing that wind and turning it into power is what drives us and is very expensive. And while we've been saying that all along, it was confirmed in the draft environmental impact statement document, where they basically said that the cost of generating power from Cape Wind would be roughly 2 to 3 times the average going, wholesale wow. cost in the area.
Okay.
And it's 2 or 3 times depending on if you include subsidies or not.
Mm-hmm.
But we're seeing that it is an extremely expensive source of power generation, and people need to understand that. We still don't know how is that going to impact our rates.
Mm-hmm.
So 6 years into this process, thousands of pages of study, and we still don't know how is it going to affect your household bill, how is
right.
it going to affect mine, how is it going to affect the public. And mm-hmm. that's something we ought to know, because we're not only subsidizing this project, but we're going to be paying for the power as well if it were to go forward.
Right. So, and back to subsidies for a moment, regardless if it's 2 to 3 times subsidies, they don't make it free. We're still paying for the project.
That's exactly.
Okay.
That's exactly right. So it's, if you take out the subsidies, it's still double.
Mm-hmm.
And if you actually, take
that.
Exactly, then you're talking at 3 times. So,
okay.
And we've seen the cancellation of other offshore projects in the past couple of years as well. Long Island Power Authority had a project that was in the same kind of permitting special treatment
right. without
bucket
the regulations.
As, exactly, bucket mm-hmm. as Cape Wind, and they were canceled basically because the consumers said, no, we don't want to pay this extra amount for this power. And we see all over the country where there's green programs being offered, they're offered at a premium, and they're offered at a premium for a reason, because it's expensive to generate.
Right.
that's not maybe the only reason not to do it, but that's something
right.
people need to understand on top of the impacts to the tribes, the impacts mm-hmm. to the fisheries, the impacts to the local economy, the impacts to, you know, the environment, you're going to have impacts to costs.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of the equation that needs to be considered.
So obviously this cost issue was a very powerful one that many people addressed during the public comment period. Were there any other comments that stood out in your mind as being
yeah,
important?
Yeah, I did. I wanted to go through a couple of them.
Okay.
For example, the Aquinnah Wampanoags, which came out in the Martha's Vineyard hearing and spoke, and they also wrote a very substantive letter into MMS. They basically say, the clear, unobstructed view across Nantucket Sound is of paramount importance to the people of the First Light, the Wampanoag people. And what they're saying is that the DIS is basically flawed.
Mm-hmm.
They haven't consulted with the tribes,
wow.
and they're portraying, you know, inaccurate information about the rights and the religious beliefs of this. And the Bureau of Indian Affairs, which is that peer agency I said before, they're also engaged on behalf of the tribes, and they're basically saying similar things. They're saying you need to consult with the tribes. You haven't followed the appropriate consultation process
mm-hmm.
that you really need to go through. Some of the other ones are just from some of the historic agencies that are
mm-hmm.
saying they're going to see a lot of adverse impacts. Massachusetts Historical Commission commented. The fisheries groups commented. For example, the New England Fisheries Management Council
mm-hmm.
is one of eight councils that put together fisheries management plans. And they've basically said that there's going to be a problem for commercial gear fishermen, that it's going to be difficult, if not impossible, to fish in the area. And they say the council remains concerned with the potential impacts this project may have on the habitat necessary to maintain healthy fish stocks and the impact the project may have on commercial fisheries. That's a big problem. I mean, that's a problem. Nantucket Sound is the engine of the Cape and Islands economy,
right.
and there are quite a few commercial fishermen that earn their livelihoods there.
Mm-hmm.
This is an impact that needs to be considered. People need to be sensitive to this.
Mm-hmm. So from what you've shared with us today, obviously MMS has a lot to sort through in the next couple months.
They definitely do. And they have to go through and address these comments
mm-hmm.
and follow the processes that they were instructed to follow, like this historic consultation process, Section 106, something
okay.
like that,
yeah.
where they have to follow it. They have to go meet with the tribes. They have to consult with the tribes. They have to come out with regulations. As I said before, the FAA is still doing studies on radar interference
mm-hmm.
as well as on local traffic patterns. The Coast Guard is looking at terms and conditions. There's a lot of steps in this process, and there's a lot of downsides. Nantucket Sound is, you know, just simply put, the wrong location for an industrial-scale power plant.
So, and it's very clear that from all this mounting evidence that Cape Wind is not a done deal.
It's not a done deal at all. And the one other thing that I want to mention to you, Katie, is in the last few weeks, a law in Massachusetts was signed, which is basically an ocean bill,
mm-hmm.
and where the state waters of Nantucket Sound, again, a unique place with state waters totally surrounding federal waters, the state portion out to 3 miles under the Massachusetts Ocean Sanctuaries Act prohibited electrical generation. Well, a few weeks ago, we signed an ocean bill, which, while is a step in the right direction in terms of managing our oceans...
Right, so we will have regulations.
We'll have some kind
mm-hmm.
of regulations. The problem is, it's now opening all the state sanctuaries to renewable energy projects. So we need to be vigilant. They're developing a plan, but we need to be vigilant to continue to protect areas like Nantucket Sound that are now basically open to development, even in the state waters.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking at a lot of risky situations with our waters, with our sanctuaries, and we need to be vigilant and we need to protect these areas, whether it's federal waters or state, from inappropriate development
mm-hmm.
like Cape Wind.
Right. So right now, while MMS is sorting through, you know, continuing their federal review process, what can our viewers do to ensure that Cape Wind is denied and that our sensitive ecosystems are protected?
Well, a few things you could do is to get engaged, talk to your neighbors, write letters to the editor,
mm-hmm.
get involved, spread the word of why this project makes absolutely no sense in Nantucket Sound. But the other thing is we have a petition online on saveoursound.org, and we're trying to get people involved in asking MMS to engage in this community consensus solution and basically come up with an area, a location, a project that we can all embrace rather than this heavily conflicted,
mm-hmm.
inappropriate one like Cape Wind. So it's time to deny Cape Wind, but we need to do something. So please sign our petition, which would basically get, hopefully, MMS engaged in finding a better alternative or a better solution.
Great. Well, I hope you all can visit saveoursound.org and enjoy the summer and enjoy the sound. Thank you.
Thank you.